Well, we've studied the ways that genes are expressed by being transcribed, producing a messenger RNA, which then can be translated into protein, or in some cases, genes are transcribed and produce functional RNAs. And now it's time to address the molecular basis of mutation, which can be defined as altered genes. It is mutations that generate genetic variation. The mutations that changes in DNA are the ultimate source of genetic variation. And just to take a few case studies from humans, this is a mutation that results in premature aging. Individuals have the bodies of very old people, elderly people, 70 years old by the time they are in their teens or early 20s. And this premature aging phenotype is caused by a mutation in a gene that encodes the lamin A protein, which you may remember from our studies of cell biology, is an intermediate filament protein that lines the nuclear envelope. So mutations in the gene that generate that protein can produce an altered form of that protein that leads to this premature aging phenotype. There's another premature aging disease, another type of progeria, in other words, that is caused by a mutation in the gene that encodes one of the DNA helicases that are involved in unwinding DNA during DNA replication and repair. And that is called Werner's syndrome. It's another progeric type of mutation. We've already talked about retinoblastoma, which is an altered gene that for the gene that encodes the retinoblastoma protein that, as you know from our studies of cell biology, regulate progression through the cell cycle. So this is a mutation in a tumor suppressor gene that produces a non-functional protein, which results in overgrowth of, in this case, retinal tissue, and in severe cases, if left untreated, can produce even lethal tumors. And not only mutations do not only produce pathologies, but are also responsible for ultimately the huge amount of genetic variation that we find in human populations. Mutation coupled with the recombination and independent assortment of chromosomes generates the huge amount of genetic variation that we find in nature and in human populations for that matter. And these two individuals, the largest man on record and one of the smallest men on record, this man he unfortunately died a few years ago. This man was under 3 feet tall and this man is 8 feet tall. And although both these individuals come from Inner Mongolia, you can see the huge amount of genetic variation that can be generated by differences in genetic constitutions, that is, differences in the alleles that individuals carry, which are ultimately derived from mutations or changes in DNA. This is another example of a growth type of mutation. These are achondroplastic individuals, and the achondroplastic phenotype is generated by a mutation in a fibroblast growth factor receptor gene, and this receptor is involved in regulating bone growth, in fact, in inhibiting bone growth. And the mutation in FGF3 that generates achondroplasia is a mutation that causes upregulation of the fibroblast growth factor 3 receptor protein as such that bone growth is actually stunted because the fibroblast growth factor receptor 3 in this case is involved in inhibiting bone growth to prevent overgrowth. And when that receptor gene is altered so that it is upregulated and overexpressed, then bone growth is inhibited. So those are just a few examples of mutations, some generating pathology, other just generating genetic variation that we find in natural populations. So let's look at the molecular basis of mutation. First, let's look at point mutations that alter a single base in a DNA sequence. And point mutations can be of the type of a base substitution, such that the genetic code is changed, that can result in some cases in the substitution of one base for another. And that substitution of one base for another can produce several results. One result is that there is no change in the protein product generated from that gene. The same amino acid is inserted despite there being a different DNA sequence in the gene that encodes the mutation that generates the protein of interest. Now, you might ask, well, how can that be? How can you change the genetic code and yet insert the same amino acid? And the answer to that, of course, as you will recall, is that the universal genetic code is degenerate in that there are multiple codons that can encode a single amino acid. So that a base substitution, a change in the genetic code, excuse me, can in fact generate a silent mutation in which the nucleic acid sequence of the gene is altered, but the protein product is not altered. The same amino acid is inserted. On the other hand, a change in the genetic sequence, the nucleotide sequence of a gene, substituting one base for another one, a base substitution, can generate a missense mutation in which an amino acid change occurs in the protein product of the gene. That is, a different amino acid is inserted from the given in the new allele compared to the original allele. And that is due to the change in the genetic code, of course. And there can be transitions or transversion mutations that are missense, that fall into the missense class. The transitions are substitutions of one type of base for the same type of base. For example, a purine to a purine, an A to a G or a G to an a C to a T or a T to a C. That is, pyrimidines are in the nucleotide sequence are changed from one purine to a different purine, or from the one pyrimidine to another pyrimidine. Whereas transversions are changes in the base sequence that change a base from a purine to a pyrimidine or vice versa. That is, an A, let's say, to a T or a C to a G, for example. Now, nonsense mutations, which can also be caused by transition or transversions, are mutations in which the genetic code is changed such that not an amino acid is inserted at all, but rather there's been a change in a codon that changes it from an amino acid coding codon to one of the three stop codons found in the universal genetic code. And as you can imagine, since stop codons stop translation when they are encountered by the ribosome, nonsense mutations lead to premature truncation of a protein and usually produce a completely non-functional protein. It's important to remember that mutation, which is the ultimate source of genetic variation, is also very important in evolution. And here's another example from human populations in which rapid evolution is seen in Tibetan populations. Now, individuals from sea level populations that migrate or that travel into high altitudes like the Tibetan Plateau, many thousands of feet above sea level, adapt to the low oxygen content at high altitudes by increasing their number of red blood cells in their blood. And they adapt then to these high altitudes. But that comes with a cost, and that cost is that the blood is more viscous with high levels of red blood cells in it. And this can be disadvantageous over the long term. Well, Tibetan populations, which have evolved from a lower living population, the Han Chinese, Tibetans have populated the Tibetan Plateau, and over 3,000 years there has been a dramatic increase in a particular allele of the EPIS1 gene. And this allele allows Tibetans to thrive at high altitudes with regular levels of red blood cells in their blood. And it's estimated that this is actually one of the most rapid evolutions ever seen in human populations, because the Han the low altitude populations and the high altitude Tibetan populations have diverged only about 3,000 years ago. Yet there's been a dramatic increase in the frequency of a variant of a genetic mutation in the EPIS1 gene in the Tibetan population, which allowed the gene to increase in frequency, allowed the allele permits the high altitude adaptation. That allele has increased from about 10% in the low altitude Han population to over 90% in the Tibetan population. So this is a very rapid increase in the frequency of that allele. Again, illustrating the importance of genetic variants or alleles in the evolution of organisms, and in this case, the evolution of a human population. Now we're ready to tackle some of the molecular bases by schematic examples. So let's look at the molecular bases of mutations. So here we have a DNA sequence in which we have the sense strand, or this is also known as the coding strand of DNA. Excuse me. And then the template strand, which is transcribed into messenger RNA. And in this schematic example, we have four codons and a stop codon, so five codons total. First codon encoding methionine, second encoding a proline, third encoding a threonine, fourth encoding an arginine, and then finally a stop codon in this example. Well, there can be a mutation that produce a single base pair mutation, a point mutation, which is silent in that we have a substitution of a CG base pair for a TA base pair. So instead of having a TA base pair, we now have a CG base pair, such that the mRNA now has a changed codon for the codon that encodes proline. Although the codon is changed from CCU in the messenger RNA to CCC, this is a silent mutation because CCC, it also encodes the amino acid proline. So this is an example of the degeneracy of the genetic code. So in this case, a change in the gene sequence of DNA, although producing an altered codon in the mRNA, produces the identical protein. So this is an example of a silent mutation. This mutation would not be seen by natural selection as any different from the original allele because the same protein, the same gene product is produced. However, we can have changes in DNA sequences that produce our missense mutations that produce changes in the amino acid sequence. So for example, here we are substituting an AT base pair for what was formerly a GC base pair. And that produces, when transcribed, a messenger RNA that has a changed codon, CAC, instead of the original CGC. So we have CGC here originally, and now due to this base pair change, we have CAC. And CAC does not encode for the original arginine at the fourth position, but rather encodes the amino acid histidine. So here we have a change in the nucleic acid sequence that results in an altered protein sequence by substituting one amino acid for another. Now, missense mutations can be severe in their consequences if the amino acid change causes a substantial change in the functioning of the protein. On the other hand, there can be missense mutations that are virtually silent in that a new amino acid is inserted instead of the original amino acid, but that change is rather conservative because the amino acid substitution is of the same type of amino acid as the original codon encoded. In that case, the missense mutation can cause little or no effect in the functioning of a protein. However, missense mutations, if a change in the amino acid sequence causes a dramatic change in protein function, can be quite severe in their consequence, in their change in phenotype, in other words. And here's another example of a point mutation. This time, we are changing to an AT base pair from a TA base pair. So we're just switching AT for what was TA on the coding and template strands. And now what we have produced at this third codon in our sequence is a stop codon, UAA, instead of the original UAU, which encodes threonine. And UAA, in this case, UAA is a stop codon. It's one of the three stop codons in the universal genetic code. So that if we had this type of mutation when the messenger RNA that results from transcription of the DNA is produced, we have a stop codon, UAA, in place of a codon which formerly inserted an amino acid. And that results then in a premature truncation of the protein. And as I stated before, nonsense mutations in which a stop codon is generated instead of an amino acid coding codon can be quite severe and usually produces a completely non-functional protein because the protein is shorter than it should be. And depending where that nonsense mutation occurs in a gene sequence, you can have very early truncation of a protein, or if it occurs much later, if the mutation occurs much later in the coding sequence, then you could have a protein which is truncated but only slightly truncated. Nevertheless, most nonsense mutations are null mutations in that they produce completely non-functional proteins. We can generalize that statement. So let's look at a few examples now. We'll pick that up in the next part of this lecture. We'll take a look at some more molecular examples of genetic mutations.